Welcome back, folks, to another session in our series in the New Testament book of Hebrews. In this session, we continue where we left off in Hebrews chapter 7, verse 4 to 28. We're looking at the perfect high priest. In last session, we asked the question, who is Melchizedek? Now in chapter 7, verse 4, we continue on with the greatness of Melchizedek. We read in chapter 7, verse 4, now observe how great this man was to whom Abraham the patriarch gave a tenth of the choicest spoils. Observe how great this man was. We're called to be observers, to be spectators, and to discern how important Melchizedek was to whom Abraham, the recipient of the promise, the patriarch of the Jewish nation, gave a tithe of the choicest spoils of war. Now, the first observation is a comparison between the sons of Levi and Melchizedek. We read in verse 5, and those indeed of the sons of Levi who receive the priest's office have commandment in the law to collect a tenth from the people, that is, from their brethren, although these are descended from Abraham. But the one whose genealogy is not traced from them collected a tenth from Abraham and blessed the one who had the promises. But without any dispute, the lesser is blessed by the greater. Abraham, the patriarch, begot Isaac, the promised son. And Isaac begot Jacob, whose name was changed to Israel, from whom the 12 tribes came. The tribe of Levi was chosen by God to be the priestly tribe under the Mosaic law. The sons of Levi who received the priestly office had commandment from the law to collect a tenth or a tithe from the people, that's from the nation of Israel, from their brethren, although they were all descended from Abraham. So we see Levi, who was descended from Abraham, who served under the Levitical system as laid out in the law, collected a tithe from the other tribes, their brethren, their brothers in the flesh, who were also descended from Abraham. But on the other hand, Melchizedek, the one whose genealogy, whose family line is not traced from the tribe of Levi, therefore he's not of the Levitical system, he collected a tithe from the patriarch Abraham, the founder of the family. Not only did Melchizedek collect a tithe from Abraham, the patriarch, but Melchizedek blessed Abraham, the one who had the promises. Now, the conclusion from this first observation is seen in verse 7. But without any dispute or without any contention, the lesser or the inferior is blessed by the greater, the superior, that which is more excellent. Melchizedek was greater than Abraham. Now, as we said, Melchizedek was an Old Testament type. Therefore, the perfect high priest would be greater than Abraham. The second observation seen in chapter 7, verse 8 says, In this case, mortal men receive tithes. But in that case, one receives them, of whom it is witnessed that he lives on. The second observation is clearly speaking about a mortal priest, in contrast to an immortal priest. Now, the word mortal means dying. And so we see in the Levitical system, dying men, dying priests, in contrast to Melchizedek being represented as immortal or deathless, a deathless priest. Melchizedek was greater because due to the absence of his ancestry, he lives on. Remember, he's a type. And so God withheld his ancestry to illustrate that the perfect high priest would be eternal, would continue on, would live on. The third and final observation seen in verse 9 and 10 says, "And so to speak, through Abraham, even Levi, who received tithes, paid tithes, for he," that's Levi, "was still in the loins," and the loins speak of internally procreative power. "He was still in the loins of his father, Abraham, when Melchizedek met him," met Abraham. Now, this passage or these verses are using the example of what's called seminal headship. So the word seminal is related to semen, or if you were to illustrate it with a plant, to the seed of a plant. Levi was Abraham's seed. So in this way, Levi paid a tithe to Melchizedek. Now, Paul the Apostle uses the same kind of argument to demonstrate in Romans 5 that when Adam sinned, all men sinned. Sin came on all men. The conclusion from this third observation shows us that through the matter of the headship of Abraham, the founding father of the Hebrew nation, his descendants, Levi, the Levitical priesthood, paid tithe to Melchizedek. Melchizedek, therefore, was greater than the Levitical priesthood and system. And this foreshadowed that the perfect high priest would be greater than the Levitical system. Now we continue on in chapter 7 with verses 11 to 19. And look at the question, what need was there for another priest? Now, Hebrews 7, verse 11 begins with, "So why is there a need for another priest?" Let's just read those verses. "Now, if perfection was through the Levitical priesthood, for on the basis of it, the people received the law, what further need was there for another priest to arise according to the order of Melchizedek, and not be designated according to the order of Aaron?" The word perfection means completion. It means fulfillment. It means absolution or release from guilt, from obligation, release from punishment. The Levitical system was established at Mount Sinai, where God gave the law through Moses. The Levitical priesthood was based on the law, and the Levitical priesthood served according to the law of God. Now, the question we're called to ask is, did the law, the Levitical system, make people spiritually whole? Did the law, the Levitical system, make people perfect? Did the law release them from guilt and punishment? Did it give people forgiveness, spiritual freedom, newness of life, a new heart? What further need would there be for another priest to arise according to the order of Melchizedek instead of continuing on with the order of Aaron, the Levitical system? Verse 12 explains that when you change a priesthood, it's a big thing. You change to another priestly order. There takes place a change of law as well. It's a big matter. So why not stay with the first setup? Continuing on in verse 13 of chapter 7, it tells us, "For the one concerning whom these things are spoken belongs to another tribe, from which no one has officiated at the altar." Who is this one concerning whom these things are spoken? Well, verse 14 says, "For it is evident that our Lord," referring to our Lord Jesus Christ, "was descended from Judah, a tribe with reference to which Moses spoke nothing concerning priests." The Lord Jesus entered this world, born of a virgin, the God-man, who came through the line of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, of the tribe of Judah, but not of the tribe of Levi, therefore not a part of the Levitical system. Moses, in the law, spoke nothing concerning priests from the tribe of Judah. No one had ever officiated at the altar in front of the tabernacle in the temple from the tribe of Judah. Now, Judah spoke of kings, and we see the promise and the covenant that God made with King David of the tribe of Judah, an eternal covenant that promised that God would set someone on his seat, on his throne, to rule forever. We read of that in 2 Samuel 7, verse 12 to 16. The greater son of David, the Lord Jesus Christ, and will sit on the throne of David in the future. But Jesus is not just a king. He is also a priest, but he's not a priest according to the order of the Levitical priesthood. He did not enter this world through the tribe of Levi. Verse 15 to 17 makes this even clearer. It says, and this is clearer still, if another priest arises according to the likeness of Melchizedek, who has become such not on the basis of a law of physical requirement, like the Aaronic priesthood, like the Levitical priests, but according to the power of an indestructible life, a permanent life, a life that cannot be broken up. Chapter 7, verse 17 quotes from Psalm 110, verse 4, and it says, you, referring to the second person of the Trinity, the Godhead, you, the Lord Jesus, are a priest forever according to the order of Melchizedek, not the Levitical system, not the line of Aaron, but the order of Melchizedek. Jesus is the perfect king priest. Now, interestingly, in the Levitical system, the Aaronic high priest garments included a turban with a crown plating on it, foreshadowing a king priest. Now, in Hebrews 7, verse 18 to 19, it summarizes the question, what further need was there for another priest? By stating the weakness and uselessness of the Levitical system. It made nothing perfect. But on the other hand, there is the bringing in of a better order. This new order, this new priest, is referred to as a better hope through which we draw near to God. Jesus, the perfect priest, according to the order of Melchizedek. Now, in case we didn't catch all of this in the first verses, the concluding verses of chapter 7, verse 20 to 28, bring before us some very important contrasts. First is this matter of an oath. We read in verse 20, and is inasmuch as it was not without an oath. For they, that's the Levitical priesthood, indeed became priests without an oath. But he, that's the Lord Jesus Christ, with an oath, through the one who said to him, and this goes back to Psalm 110, verse 4 again, the Lord has sworn, the Lord has made an oath, and will not change his mind. You are a priest forever. Okay, the Lord has sworn, the Lord made an oath. Now, just a little bit before this, in chapter 6, verse 13, it speaks about God's promise to Abraham when he promised him this covenant, the Abrahamic covenant. And at the center, as we said last session, is the promised seed, the king, the priest, the perfect priest, the seed that is promised way back in Genesis 3:15. And God promised Abraham, but he also included in that promise an oath, Since he could swear by no one greater, he swore by himself, saying, I will surely bless you, and I will surely multiply you. And so, having patiently waited, he obtained the promise. God never breaks his promises, but also to state that even clearer, he swore an oath and took full responsibility, so that by two things, the promise and the oath, we might have complete confidence in him. Now here in chapter 7, we see that God swore an oath regarding a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek, the perfect high priest, the Lord Jesus Christ, the second person of the Godhead. The Lord has sworn, he's taken full responsibility. He not only promised a perfect high priest, but he's taken full responsibility by swearing an oath and will not change his mind. You are a priest forever. So verse 22 says, Jesus has become the guarantee. We have this tremendous guarantee because of this. A guarantee of a better covenant. The first covenant was weak and useless. But here we have this perfect priest with a perfect covenant. And God has promised and takes full responsibility of this. Well, we continue on and we see a second contrast. And we've touched on this a little bit in the earlier verses. But verse 23 says, the former priests, on the one hand, existed in greater numbers because they were prevented by death from continuing. Now it's said that from the time of Aaron to the destruction of the temple in 70 AD, there were 84 high priests. So you had Aaron, and then Aaron died, and then you had the next one, and the next one, and the next one, all the way to 70 AD. Weak men who needed to offer a sacrifice first for themselves, for they too were sinful, and then for the people who were sinful, and then they died, and then the next one came along. But Jesus, it says in verse 24, on the other hand, in contrast, because he continues forever, holds his priesthood permanently. It's unbroken. And because of this, verse 25, he is able to save forever those who draw near to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. Verse 26, for it was fitting for us to have such a high priest, holy, innocent, undefiled, separated from sinners, and exalted above the heavens. And here's this third contrast. Who does not need daily, like those priests, high priests, to offer up sacrifices first for his own sins and then for the sins of the people? Because this he did once for all. Jesus is sinless, perfect, undefiled. And he offered himself once for all. The Levitical system, they offered up goats and bulls and birds. And this could not give the worshiper a clear conscience. This could not take away sin. And they kept doing it. It was a continual reminder of sin. And it was a foreshadowing of that perfect sacrifice and perfect priest. But finally, the perfect priest came, Jesus Christ, and he offered up himself once. Not many, many times, but only needed to offer himself up once for all. The law appoints men, it says in verse 28, as high priests who are weak. But the word of the oath that we talked about just a little while ago, verse 21, which came after the law, and we see that oath in Psalm 110, verse 4, the Lord has sworn, appoints a son. God appointed his son, made perfect forever. What a difference between the Levitical system and the perfect high priest according to the order of Melchizedek. In verse 28, we find five important truths here. First, the Levitical system under the law was weak and inadequate. It appointed weak men. But we see, secondly, that God had something better, his son, of which God declared and appointed with an oath. This better way, thirdly, this better priest who made a better covenant came after the law. So we see, not under the law, but by grace, apart from the Levitical system and the law, God appointed a perfect high priest. Fourthly, the phrase made perfect points to Christ, the perfect Son of God, attesting to his perfection through his suffering during his ministry on earth, and therefore showing himself qualified to be the perfect high priest. Hebrews 5, verse 8 to 9 speaks about this. And finally, Jesus is a priest forever, not for a little bit, but forever. He never dies. Did you catch this powerful truth that Jesus Christ is alive? He took our sins, he died and paid for them fully, made atonement completely. Then he rose again and lives forever. He is at the right hand of the Father today, alive forevermore. He is physically alive as we sit here and talk. What was the purpose of the Levitical priesthood and the order of Melchizedek? Well, the Levitical priesthood and the law simply diagnosed the problem. The problem is sin, and gave us the prognosis, death. Simply that. That was its purpose. Sin, death. But Melchizedek, who appeared as an Old Testament type to Abraham in chapter 14 of Genesis, gave a picture and an assurance of God's perfect answer to the sin problem. This would be found in a perfect high priest with an indestructible life who would come as the central part of the promise God made with Abraham. Do you have someone interceding for you before the Father today? Do you have this perfect high priest, the only perfect high priest, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, born of a virgin, perfectly ministered on this earth, fully died in your place as your sacrifice, your substitute, fully rising from the dead, fully ascending to the Father's right hand, alive forevermore? Whoever lives to make intercession for those who by simple faith put their trust in him as Savior and Lord.